So we're very pleased to have Shou-Wu Zhang from Princeton University, who used to be one of the organizers of this seminar a long time ago. It's nice to have you back for a few minutes at least. He will be speaking on equidistributions of small points.
Thank you for inviting me back. I didn't realize that it's we ask people to give so many talks. Okay, so I gave first lecture to graduate students, just explain there's highs, very highs and narrow highs. And in particular, I talk about this outstanding conjecture, still outstanding. It's called Lemma's conjecture. So that's I learned from Columbia at the graduate course by Ted Chinberg. He gave a course, you know.
Which Lemma conjecture, about tau of n?
No, about the high Mahler measure.
Oh, the Mahler measure. That's a different one.
Yeah, yeah, Mahler measure. So that's that one I learned from Ted Chinberg.
Can you remind me what it is?
I'm going to remind you.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm going to talk a review this thing. And my my work, you know, is more or less a reflect my graduate work from Columbia to do similar problem, but for points over a variety, not only points without any abstraction. That is formulated in terms of something called Bogomolov conjecture. And to do the Bogomolov conjecture, then the main tools is to use something called equidistribution theorem, which I formulate with both Shapiro and Ulamo. And this equidistribution theorem was played a major role to prove the Bogomolov conjecture. And then something is done. And so everything supposed to be done in 1998, something like that. But recently, they have a lot of interest and the extension of this problem. So in particular, apply to the moduli of curves and the modular dynamic system to get a uniform bound of their other problems. So today's lecture, I have three purposes. First, review what I have done a long time ago for graduate students. And then I review the recent work. I think it's pretty exciting work for uniform bound model line conjecture, uniform bound of Bogomolov conjecture. You guys probably needed to invite these people to give a talk. So finally, I want to introduce my recent work with Xinyi Yuan. It's a long paper, it's 180 pages. So I have not yet completely checked the detail, but I will try and explain the main result. Okay, so so I will start with a very basic definition in case it just normalize the notation I'm gonna use. So we start with the very highs, the highs on an algebraic number, a rational number is normalized by maximal of the coordinates, right? It's one of the most classical way to measure the complexity of an algebraic number and also the point in a projective space. So that's the one main notion in diophantine geometry. As I just said, even for this very trivial definition, elementary definition, we already have a non-trivial conjecture there. It's called Lemma's conjecture. The conjecture say that if you have algebraic number and whose height, which is not zero or roots of unity, then its height cannot be too small. Is at least as big as a reciprocal of the degree, right? So this is a very striking conjecture, so elementary. And the many people, I know many people work on it, but nobody really proved it, get a final result. I think recently, Dimitrov got something and proved some variation of this conjecture and some very the weak form of this conjecture. So I leave, and I didn't really check the details, but the thing seems a very interesting thing. Okay, then from the Wei conjecture, yeah, Wei invented, developed this notion of the heights because he wanted to prove the model Wei theorem. The model Wei theorem, the model is a part of the proof in 1922. And without using this notion of heights, then Wei formally introduced the heights. Then he proved the model Wei theorem 1928, I believe. Then the heights was further normalized by two people. One's a Nehong, one's a Tate. Nehong, he developed his theory of Nehong model. On this model, that he computed the heights, give an explicit formula how to compute the heights. And Tate found an algorithm, just computed the heights globally. So the Tate's algorithm is rather simple. If you start with the elliptic curve, then you consider x coordinates. Inside the coordinates, you compute, you can talk about the heights. And if you iterate by multiply by two, your heights change is almost like four each time. If we take a limit, then you get so-called the Nehong, the Tate's algorithm, Tate's height. And this height is beautiful. It has a very beautiful property. First of all, it's non-negative. Second thing, if you modulate the torsion, it become a quadratic form on the elliptic curve. And so in particular, you can talk about a regulate, right? If you have a generate of the model Wei group, then you can talk about the volume generated by generates. And this height, of course, the measure the torsion points. The height also satisfy something called the Northcutt property. So that's the very first thing. That also has a conjecture, Lemma's conjecture in this case. But it's not due to Lemma, it probably is due to Silverman, other people. So it's about the height on the elliptic curve. It cannot be too small, at least bounded by degree, some constant over degree of the x. And when I was a grad student, I spent a lot of time on this kind of thing. I proved some small results on this kind of stuff. Yes, but it's still open. Okay, so this is my two slides on the elementary theory of Nehong tidal heights. As I say, my purpose is not to prove Lemma's conjecture, but to start to understand the other question that I found in geometry. So let's review some theorems, classical theorem, two classical theorems about the rational points whose proof used heights. So one is the model Wei theorem I just explained. If A is on abelian variety of a number field, then we know the rational points of K will form a subgroup of the abelian variety. There's a famous model Wei theorem say this group is finitely generated. This is the first major theorem in divergent geometry. The next one, it's slightly harder, right? It's called a model Lan plus Fortins. Model Lan plus, yes. So that X be a subvariety of abelian variety over a number field. Suppose this variety is not a translation of abelian subvariety. Then the K rational points on this variety is not Cyrus Gittins. So this theorem is approved first for curve in 1993 by Fortins using, he first proved the Ted's conjecture and then proved this conjecture as Ted's conjecture, then Shavarovich conjecture, then use a portion of the trick to get this conjecture. And then later on, they reproved by Paul Volta and used a much more elementary method, still for curves. Then Fortins, then using they extend the Volta theorem to arbitrary subvariety abelian variety. And the main tool of the proof theorem is a more sophisticated theory of line bundles on their abelian varieties and their product. Because for abelian variety, you can form, even starts with one line bundle, you can get many different line bundles by taking products or quotients. There are many other ways to do that. Okay, so the third major theorem is called a Manning-Manford conjecture. It's proved by Reynolds. It's also 1983. Which is say that if X is a subvariety of abelian variety, which is not a translation of abelian subvariety by torsion points, then this subvariety and cannot have a dense subset of torsion points. And the Reynolds original proof is basically a periodic method. And then later on, find many different proofs they find. And I and Ilumo, we reprove the theorem as a consequence of a Bogomolov conjecture. And there's some other proof using model theory. And so anyway, so the formulation is pretty similar. So I put them together. And later on, we realized that actually they actually related to each other. So then there's a nice way to combine all three conjectures. The first one, the combined two theorems, the Modell-Lehn and the Manning-Manford. So what do you do instead of finitely generated subgroup, you can talk about subgroup of finite rank. Finite rank means that if you have abelian group, you tensor Q, it becomes Q vector space, right? The Q vector space has a rank, has a dimension. This is called a rank of original group. So only the difference between this one and the other one is your group may be very divisible, right? In the original group, it's finite generated. You don't really allow a lot too many divisions, but this guy can have a lot of divisions. So that relation, so usually you start with the finite generated group, then you take all the division points, you get a second group. Then of course, there's a very famous question that remain. We still don't know how to solve them. So first question is how to bound the rational points, the elliptic curves, a rational point, the abelian variety. This is a how to find the generates of these points. And this is related to the BSC conjecture. It's not exactly the same, but it's still related to. And we don't know how to find the generates of the points, a model of a group. The theorem is approved in 1928 after 90 something, almost 100 years after Model's theorem, we still don't know how to effectively construct the points and elliptic curve. The second one is even more harder. For a curve hygienist, how can we actually compute every point? I don't know even harder or not, but it's very similar. But the second question is related to the ABC conjecture, right? If we can prove ABC in a very general form, then we can find all the points. So this is something called the effective model conjecture. The third question is how to bound X tor this set. And this Probably it's easier, but still also we don't know how to describe them. And except a very few cases, we can explicitly compute the points by Chapoti method, Coleman Chapoti. But general process, we don't know how to compute torsion points and curve. Okay, so this is pretty much the something happened in 1980s, right? And the first theorem proved in 1928. The second question supposed to be the PhD thesis is on the way, but it really proved 1983. Now let's move on a little bit. Then when I was a PhD student, so my question we're trying to handle is called a Bogomolov conjecture. So I just write on the conjecture there. So now we can see it. Abelian variety, sub-variety abelian variety. We assume this is not a sub-variety, abelian sub-variety translated by a torsion points. So in other words, we assume X is not a component of the subgroup. Then the theorem say this X should not have many small points, many points of small height. So yeah, right, very precisely. So there should be a positive number such that all the points on this subvariety whose height is bounded by this small number epsilon is not a Zariski dense. So this is called a Bogomolov conjecture. Bogomolov original conjecture is actually much funny. He talked about give you a curve in the Jacobian. He wants to understand there's a nanometer height defined kind of pseudo distance on this curve. He wanted to understand what the distance function look like. So his conjecture that this pseudo distance function should be discrete, right? So pseudo discrete. So that's original conjecture, but then the former writer here is very different. So for his conjecture, you needed to concede curve X cross X map to Jacobian, right? So that's the thing there. So the main ingredient of the proof of the conjecture is to develop a new intersection theory called eidetic line bundles, which I'm going to explain later. And also there is a part of this line bundle, there's some equidistribution theorem for projective varieties. This is approved, it's a joint work with me, Shapiro and Ulumo. Then some extensions of the theorem to other situation. There's a multiplicative group that's done by myself. There's semi-abelian variety by Shambhalua. There's also the model Lamb plus Bogomolov is by Bjorn Poonen, and I make an equidistribution theorem there. So this is pretty much everything in 1990s. So I just show, since my title, my lecture is about equidistribution, I'm trying to show that how do I prove the Bogomolov conjecture as a special case of equidistribution theorem. So let's talk, the equidistribution theorem, I just gave a definition, we're going to talk a lot about that. So let X be a topologic space with a probabilistic measure, dx is kind of Borean measure. And so you take a sequence of a finite subsets, okay, of X, Sn, each Sn is finite. So we say that the sequence is equidistributed with respect to the probability measure. If the Dirac measure for these sets converges to the probability measure you choose. So you write it more precisely, Okay, a lot of typos here because I just typed in the morning. So for any continuous function, the valuation of your function on this subset, you take an average, you will get an integral. So the theorem I proved for Bogomolov conjecture is the following. So let A be a Abelian variety of a number field. Let Xn be a sequence of points Ak. Satisfy two conditions. First condition, the highest goes to zero. The second condition is for any proper subgroup G of X, there are at most finite many points Xn in G, right? So then for any complex embedding K to C, the Galois orbits, all of the points we choose is equidistributed with a Hard measure and Xcn. So that's the theorem. So you see the funny thing, when you look at the theorem, there's almost nothing to do with the Bogomolov conjecture, but this implied Bogomolov conjecture is quite an easy way. So I just explain why the spatial. So I write a spatial equidistribution because later on we'll talk about a generic equidistribution, why spatial equidistribution theorem implies Bogomolov is easy. Suppose you have X inside A and not translated by points. So we assume that X generates A. Right, as a group. And then if you have a sequence points X here, inside X, right? If the theorem is not true, you're going to have, if a Bogomolov fails, we'll give you some points, the limit, limit of Xn will be zero. Second part is Xn, we connect to the generic points. So no subsequence. No subsequence is no infinite subsequence. It's inside a proper subvariety. Okay. And then this second condition will implies this condition. No proper subgroup is including this stuff. And then by the spatial equidistribution theorem set, and then this Galois orbits, we are convergent to the dx. This is a hard measure on A of C. But on the other hand, this guy is already inside X of C, right? I mean, so you see, this guy cannot, so there's D of X, so this will fall, this is impossible, right? If you have subsequence, it's already a closed subset, you're not gonna equidistribute it inside of the big variety. So that's the theorem we prove a Bogomolov conjecture. So it's really, we didn't prove Bogomolov conjecture directly, we just show a different, much stronger condition. The condition is strong, the reason, for example, have other consequences, related lemma conjecture. For example, if my Xn are totally real, totally real, then O of Xn is inside the A of the real torus, inside the A of C. So from this guy, we show that like a lemma's conjecture is trivially true for any, there is epsilon bigger than zero, such as that for any X inside A Q bar, totally real, the height of X is bigger than epsilon. So we don't even need to divide by degree. So it's a very strong theorem. So equilibrium theorem is very nice. Then there were some extensions by Bilu, right? And by Chambaloa and by Xin Yi Yuan and a different situation. Okay, so this is pretty much how Bogle model of conjectures is approved. It's approved using equidistribution theorem, which I explain later. Now I jump to the recent beautiful work by two group of people, by Dimitrov, Gao, and Habeck, and by Lars Kuhn. So they prove so-called uniform model land conjecture. This is a really amazing theorem. So I could not really imagine, you know, this can be proved 30 years ago. So they say for any G greater than two, there exists a positive number C1G with the following property. Let us see, be any smooth curve of a complex number. And with an embedding, any embedding C to Jacobian C by a point P in C, any endpoint. Okay? Let gamma be Jacobian C, a subgroup of finite rank. Okay, this rank is the row equal dimension of gamma tensor Q. So this row can change. Then the theorem say the number of the points, lattice points on this C, is bounded by C1 over G, one plus rho. This is amazing because it doesn't depend on anything. So if you apply this thing to the curve in the Jacobian, you have number field, you have many other things. So this theorem was originally proved by Dimitrov, Gao, and Habeck with a constant depends on number field. And here, everything it doesn't depend on anything, right? Some other cases done by something. Of course, you know, then this Barry Mazur conjecture that it should not have a role there. But this depends you believe. If we believe that the abelian variety with fixed dimension whose model rank is universally bounded, then this is true, right? Some people believe this is true. Right. I think that's Bian Punan even has a model to show that the model rank should be universally bounded.
Is G the genus of the curve?
Yes.
Because you didn't say that. Okay.
Oh, I didn't say. Right. Okay. Okay. G is the genus of curve. Yeah. So this is called uniform model length conjecture. So really very. General results, and then there's uniform Bogle model conjecture. I also forget about genus. So let the G greater than two be an integer. Let the two integers, C1, G, C3, G, such as that is following true. For any smooth curve C of genus G, and the same embedding as before, then the points on this curve whose height is bounded by C2 of G, the number of such points is bounded by C3 of G, right? This is also really strong, very strong result. And so they prove these results of something like this, that they use something I do not know. I mean, there's at least the first thing, they use something called a Betti map. And all minimality. Of course, they work on the relative situation. So when I work on the statistics problems, I work on single number field. But then these people now work on the modular space of curves. And then they started something called a Betti map or minimality for associated Jacobian, right? You have a Jacobian. And then they prove a height inequality comparison for variety and a curve and a base varieties, MG. And recently the Kuhn proved a new equidistribution theorem for quasi-projective variety. And the difficulty of these arguments, this MG, the modular space of curves is a quasi-projective variety. It's not projective variety. So So the theory developed in my work, and Shen-Yi's work does not apply automatically. But nevertheless, all these people, they figure out a different way to do that. So that's pretty interesting. The funny thing that Shen-Yi and I already had a thought about this theory 11 years ago, you know, 2012, something like that, trying to extend the equidistribution theorem to quasi-projective varieties. And then recently we sort of realized that, and we can prove, we can give some kind of a simplified or conceptual reasoning for their the Arakelov theory they use. So that's one reason for my lecture. So these two results just announced in January of this year. So it's a pretty new result. Any questions so far?
So since you mentioned about the effectivity, can you comment on the effectivity in these uniform bonds?
Uniform bond effectivity? You mean these constants?
Yes.
No. I don't know. Maybe ask Zian, the Kun. You should ask them to give a talk. My feeling is far from effective. I mean, they don't know how to get it. Because in particular, for Kuhn's theorem, they rely on equidistribution theorem. Equidistribution is usually not very effective.
Yep. Zian actually gave a talk 2 years ago.
This is a new one.
Yeah, at that time it was not effective. So I was just wondering if there's any progress.
No. Okay. But this is stronger than that time, right? That time dependent number theory.
That's right, yeah.
Here, the dependent number field is gone. So I can say these numbers probably get even more worse.
I see.
Right? I don't know. I mean, there could be, I probably fairly say they probably not yet think about effectivity seriously. Right. Okay, so that's the thing. So, okay, so now I go back to review. How long my lecture is supposed to be?
1 hour, yeah.
Okay, yeah, so I have plenty of time. Okay, so I needed to, I first review the older theory. After reading all the theory, now start talking about new theory. So the order theory is to define kind of the degree or intersection theory on the arithmetic varieties. So we're doing the theory in terms of Lucien Shapiro's language called compactification. You need to compactify everything, in all the steps. So my order theory is only involve arithmetic compactification. So mean that my variety I choose is already projective, but defined over a number field. So the arithmetic compactification means that I need to take care of the places, valuations, right? So doing there. So let's start with basic definition. So you start with a K a number field. OK is the ring of integers. So we know OK is not a compact object. So in order to get a compact object, you need to check the Archimedean valuations, right? So then you get a product formula. So anyway, by Hermitian invertible module, L on OK, we mean the invertible module with a Hermitian norm on, for each invariant. And we make this norm to be compatible with complex conjugation, but this is a minor thing. It depends what you do. Once we put this, this data, so let me try to say, so this this data, in some sense, in Lucian's period language, so you get L, you get two parts, sigma divided by infinity. These parts, you, in some sense, you can set the compactification. Compactification process, right? So I usually call it arithmetic compactification, because only involve the number fields. So once you put extra data come from a random place, then you can define the degree of your invertible shape or invertible module. You know, that's analog of line bundles or curves. Okay, so you define it by, you take any section. Sorry, this is bad. This should be log number L of OK, L OK. Yeah, so you get this thing. So then we let pick OK be the ring of the isomorphism class, a Hermitian OK invertible modulus. So that's like, it's more like analog of Picard group in for algebraic curves, right? But if you, this is one way. Other way, if you say, I really don't want to input the Archimedean place, if we forget the compactification, you also get another beautiful thing. It's called a class group, right? So the class group, a compactified thing, is just one, two step. If you want to have a, if you want to have a degree map, then you get compactified. And this compactified has more information you can imagine. So for example, so this is a pick hit of OK. Of course, you can map two things. You can map to pick OK, right? But forget the metric structure. You can map to real number, take a degree, right? So you can take a degree product this guy. Right, and then this is nothing. This kernel is nothing. The kernel is a regular module. So it's a standard module. If we remember, it's R1 direct sum CR2 of zero there. And let me see. It's not by this way. R to the R1. Plus R2, and okay, so that's a sum equals zero. I forget something like that. Then divide by log of OK cross. So this is basically regulated group, right? So this guy come from more informations, right? Then there, so this is a class group. So this guy has a more, is a nice way to put everything together. Okay, so once you have a compactified, can define degree. The degree is the thing we're gonna use. And we also can consider adelic version. Adelic version is the point that you compactify by Archimedean place. So in other words, at Archimedean place, you know, at a finite place, we have a very rigid structure. For example, the line bundle, the elements, the periodic norm should be, I mean, the discrete. And then in there, then I define adelic version. Adelic version is that, well, adelic invertible module L bar, we just say a free module L over K of rank one. Okay, it's just a free is a vector space, right, of K rank one with a collection of a KV norm, right? So for each V, I put a norm there. So so I give it maximum freedom, but I require that for any section, the norm of the section should be one for all but finite many V there. So in this way, I can define a degree. So the adelic one we give a complete equal treatments between the finite place and Archimedean place, right? So we don't view OK is more special than other thing. Finite place is more special than Archimedean place. Of course, there is a map between Hermitian modules to idyllic modules. You just needed to define for each Hermitian module, you define a norm by this formula, right? You just, if you have a section, if your section is inside the unit module, you just divide this number. So that's an easy translation between Hermitian and idyllic one. So this is in the dimension one case, just arithmetic curve. For this, call this setting, Lucien Shapiro had complete treatments like Riemann theorem, at least for these parts. He has a Riemann theorem. He used the Riemann theorem to prove all the classical theorems for number fields. It's very interesting treatment, very uniform. Okay, so that's not my purpose. So okay, now we can move to heights using Hermitian line bundles. So at the very beginning, we have a theory of heights, but this only for heights of a point. But we can make much more use the language of line bundles. The reason is we can treat the sub-varieties, right? Because for heights, that's, you know, you don't really, for one point it's okay. For sub-variety, heights could not do much. So we start with a projective variety X of Q. Then we take a projective model of X over Z, right? Projective flat model. By a Hermitian line bundle, we mean a pair of a line bundle and X, sorry, it should be X, and a smooth collection of the norms and the complex lines. So the metric and the line bundle are complex manifold, right? So this is the line bundle, just extension of the Hermitian invertible module for number field, we get a variety. So we have a notion of the Hermitian line bundles, group of Hermitian line bundles. Now, for such a line bundle, we can define the height. The height is defined if you have a point in the X, so that's like a generic fiber of your integral model. Then you take a zero closure, it becomes a arithmetic curve, right? If you have, you know, yes, the picture will be like that. So this is a spec OK or spec Z. It doesn't really matter because there's something like that. You get something like this then. So, okay, let me just this guy. So this is infinity. Okay, so then this is a generic fiber. Zero, right? And the general five, there's a P here, two, three other things. So if you have a point here, then you can take you become a curve inside. And so this is X, this X bar. And then if you have line bundle L here, then L of X bar, it's a more like a line bundle in peak. Okay, right? So for example, X bar define a map from okay. So then you can compute a degree. You compute a degree, you normalize by another degree because your points are degree. So you have a relative degree, vertical degree. The relative degree, I mean, the absolute degree divided by relative degree is usually kind of height. So this pretty much normalized. So for example, if you take a projective space, you take this, the bounded O1 bundle, right? So projective space, Pn, each point represent a line inside n plus one dimensional space. O1 bundle, if you don't want to know the definition, is a dual space of the vector space to start with, right? Because for X, you know, if you think X as a quotient space, then each point. Anyway, so this is a dual base. Right, this is the point. And then your points, this section, the norm will be defined by this way. If you use this way to define the heights, you will get the value height. So this is the value height. And then, as I say that, I mean, you use a line bundle because you want to do something more fancy. Otherwise, you know, we call it the height machine, right? And then in all the treatment, it's just each line will define the height, the modulus, the bundle functions, the heights and the line bundle are determined to each other. But that's not the thing we're going to use. We want to use heights, not only defined the complexity of points, but it's we want to use a line bundle not only define the height of points. We also want to use them to define the height of a subvariety. So if we start with a subvariety, y here, and then we define the heights by exactly the same process. So what we're going to do is, if you have, this is x, then you have a y inside, then you have a line bundle. Then you can restrict the line bundle on y. Then there's this theory of Gilles-Soleil can allow you to define the intersection numbers of the line bundle by itself. It's pretty much an induction process. You get a one section, then define the divisor, then use the divisor to define the block, is the induction process. Anyway, you get a height. And for abelian variety, the funny thing, you can use exactly the Tate's algorithm to define a narrow tailed height, not only for the point, even for subvariety. That's already pretty interesting. For example, when curve inside the Jacobian, you can define a new invariant called narrow tailed height of your curve. This is a rather deeper invariant, okay? Okay, so, but this process is a bit of funny. The process, it's an integration process. It's very difficult to use the process to prove some theorems in a more rigorous way. So that was the reason I introduced a notion called eidetic line bundle and the varieties. Because this process, you think about it, you start with abelian variety of a number field. You take a projective model of this abelian variety. Unless your abelian variety has good reduction everywhere, this projective model will not be a natural one, right? Because your group law cannot extend to the projective model, right? So you're going to have some trouble. So when you define the heights, you'll become, okay, I have a Y, a subvariety, I take a Zeller seclusion. But if I want to define the two times the Y, I have to multiply my, variety twice and then generalify, but then take a Zeller seclusion. I have to do all these different approaches. So this is why I was not very happy with that. So I define eidetic line bundles. A delicate line bundle exactly same. So it's arithmetic compactification. So the idea will be, let me write on it. The idea will be if you have x over x over spec of k, then you extend a little bit xu over u. U is the open subsets of spec OK. Then I started to a compactification. The compactification of this guy. And this compactification, so I put a metric on everywhere. So in this way, I get some kind of arithmetic compactification. So then I get a line bundle. But if we do this way, you're not going to use, it's not going to be useful because you do too arbitrary, then all the Gillet-Soleil, the intersection theory will not be extended to that. So then I, so in my older work, I figured out a very nice process to do this thing. You just needed to do slightly careful. So first, you consider all these models, right? You access a lot of models. Each model you have is a Hermitian line bundles. Then you put all this model together, you get the model metric. The inside the model metric, you have a nef cone. There's a cone inside. Inside is a cone, you take a completion. After you do the completion, then you take a difference. So it's a very delicate process. I mean, this process it's not exactly straightforward, but at the end of the day, it works perfectly. So we can have intersection theory on the identical line bundles. It applied to abelian variety and a dynamic system perfectly. Even the abelian variety does not have good reduction everywhere, but you have the best identical matrix line bundle everywhere. So this is a very miracle thing happened. So we use this identical line bundles to prove prove various things. So most important thing we prove is called a generic equidistribution theorem, because before we prove so-called the spatial equidistribution theorem, that's generic equidistribution theorem. Before I do that, I give a small definition because this is going to use a lot. So let X be a variety defined of a number field with a height function. Let Xn be a sequence of points there. Then we say this sequence of points is small points. This is a sequence series of small points if the limit goes zero. I just define notation. So the small points is not a, it's actually has a precise definition. We say the sequence is generic if there's no infinite subsequence of Xn is included in a proper closed subvariety. So in other words, these points in Zariski topology, convergent to the generic points. So then there's a theorem proved first by Yulomo, Shapiro, and myself. Maybe I should switch this to name here. For projective variety with a smooth generic fiber, and then later generalized to arbitrary dimension by Xingyi Yuan in his PhD thesis. The theorem right now is write down like the following way. So let X be a projective variety of a number field K. Let the error be on the nef identical line bundle X, such that a degree error of X is bigger than zero. Let Xn be a generic point sequence of small points with respect to this height. Then for every place V of K, the Galois orbits is equidistributed. With a measure, so the measure is sometimes called a Shambhala measure induced from the invariant curvature form of L. So this is the most general theorem. We prove for projective varieties. The most important thing is for projective variety. And I finished introduction to my older work with Xingyi Yuan and Yulomo and Shapiro. I don't know, should we take a break now or I continue?
Well, it's almost finished. I mean, you technically-
No, you don't have another one, okay.
You only have 5 more minutes, but you can go over if you want.
Okay, sorry, I got confused. I saw you have another 30 minutes.
No, that's when we do a live performance. For the internet, we just do 1 hour talk, very simple.
Okay, so I'm gonna do fast. Actually, it's very easy. It's not difficult. Okay. Okay, so now I do geometric compatibilization. I said more algebra geometry, geometric compatibilization. So let X over K quasi-projective variety. And then what we can do is the following thing. We can concede X tilde, the projective system. Of the project compatifications. Of X, so in other words, each of these things is given by X map to X bar. Okay, something like that, right? So this bar is going to change. So this system. Then, of course, from this thing, we get a pick. X tilde is the direct limit of the peak of X bar here. Yeah? Then we introduce a topology in this set called a boundary topology. The idea that you can start with a base one, starts with any base one, fix. X goes to X zero bar, and X zero bar where the difference, take the X here, you get a D here. So we can define a top boundary topology. If you have a bound L on X, you have L on X bar, and you have two extensions, say I have this thing, two different, you know, if you have L there, I have two different line bundles, L1, L2. When you restrict the two line bundle on an X, a SAM, say, okay, so the LI is L with the DI. So DI is a boundary there. So we define the divisor of a D. 1 minus d2 is less than epsilon of d0, bigger than negative epsilon of d0. So d0 is here. So this gives you a topology on all the extensions. So then we define the peak. Tilde of x is the completion of peak x tilde. With respect to topology. This is exactly the same way I'm doing when we do a number field, but this is purely algebra geometry thing, right? So we can see a quasi-projective variety, can see all their projective compatifications, then we'll get many line bundles. And okay, so we start with X quasi-projective. We define this geometric compatification. Then from here, we can define a rhizomatic compatification. A rhizomatic compatification is similar, but you're going to do, you're going to take X over Z to X bar over Z. So you take the Hermitian bundles, X bar. Then you take a limit. Then you take the compatification. So we get a two picture. You get a two different picture. One is X hat there, good pick X tilde there. These, when X is projective, if X is a projective already, this is nothing, just pick X itself, right? And then we define the similar thing. So the main theorem will be the equidistribution theorem. On X is similar. So if you start with a bundle L, so we still call it idyllic bundle, such that L tilde, so that's the L, the image, I mean, for this map there, L restricted X tilde is nef. And a big. If you have xn points, which is small and a generic, then the Galois orbits are equidistributed on X. So that's the theorem. This theorem is greatly extend the theorem, early theorem, with Shapiro and Ulomo, because that's a quasi-projective. The application is the last, I don't know how many negative minutes I used. So the application you can apply to MG, AG, and all, so this, all the dynamic system, the moduli of dynamic system. Right, and for these two, we reproof and or generalize all the work by some height inequality. So we prove the height inequality. Of Dimitrov, Habeck and Gao. And we also give a proof of the equidistribution theorem of the last Kuhn. We also prove some equidistribution theorem for the post, what is that, notation. So something in a dynamic system, equidistribution theorem of the, let me see. Of the PCF points, the post-critical finite points on the moduli of the dynamic system of the F from P1 to P1. So that's the everything I'm going, yeah, that's some applications. The whole point is that now the theorem is about a quasi-projective variety, not projective. So the compactification, we take all the compactifications, not only one compactification. And the singularity we allow is much better than singularity treated like in Fulton's work, in the Fulton Heights, because our singularity, for example, even for modular curve, if a modular curve, a modular curve, you know, in the typical singularity in Fulton's work, other people's work, it's a log that can only allow the O log Q, small O, but we can really involve the much bigger singularity in our calculation. Because our method is more global than local method. So I should stop here.
Okay, thank you very much. Does anyone have any questions?
What do you mean by the application to the Dimitrov, Habegger, Gao, and Kuhnet? You mean this gives another proof of it?
Yes, it's a much simpler proof. It's a much general situation. So the theorem, if I remember correctly, because the language we use are different, much more sophisticated. So the theorem, I think one theorem we can prove is you start with AG. This is universal. This is universal, the modular stack of abelian varieties. It suppose has, okay, I don't know, this is okay. Suppose you have some V sub-variety inside, right, over S here. Suppose here you have a line bundle, or one bundle, L. And see, our notion, we define a notion called L, the degree, yeah, so that's the funny thing, because this is Boson quasi-projective. Suppose the V is generic, the degree of a line bound on V. Yeah, that's already interesting because quasi-projective is bigger than zero. Then we show that for any C bigger than zero, there exists an epsilon bigger than zero, such as that the height of X, for any X inside of V greater than epsilon, this is for L. At bottom, you can get a line bound there. M of, say, this moving the pi, pi of X minus C. So this is the fundamental inequality proved by Gao, by Habeck, Gao, and Dimitrov, right? So when Xiang was here, you know, so I saw this has something to do with bigness. And Shen Yu just realized that this is a very easy consequence of our theory.
Are there any other questions?
Maybe one quick question. The space X hat that you constructed at the end, the projective limit of projective compactifications, is that, does that have an explanation in terms of valuations as well? It just reminds me of.
Yeah, this is traditionally called Riemann characteristic space.
Yes. And can your, I guess your,
In fact, it is a scheme.
Is happening on this Zariski-Riemann space, or
it is in fact a scheme.
I see.
Yeah. So we put a topology there. The topology is new.
I see.
Yeah. We not only put a, we don't really take a direct limit. The direct limit, we put a topology inside. And we define a certain subspace so that you can define the section theory there.
Thank you.
Yeah. Any more questions? Well, let's thank Shou again.
Thank you.